In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Remember, O most chaste spouse of the Virgin Mary, that never was it known that anyone who fled to thy protection, implored thy help, or sought thy intercession was left unaided. Inspired by this confidence, I fly unto you, my spiritual Father, and I beg your protection. O foster Father of the Redeemer, despise not my petitions, but in your goodness hear and answer me. Amen. Heavenly Father, during this time of this live stream on the day 2 of consecration to Saint Joseph, we pray for your blessing upon us, for an outpouring of your Holy Spirit upon us, that we would come to know and love in a deeper way the great Saint Joseph, so that through him we can fall more in love with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Help us today to open up the significance of the great litany of Saint Joseph and to really treasure this prayer that you have given to the church. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, amen. So, started with the memorare to Saint Joseph. So I bet you, there's no way I can take a poll or see your hands or anything, but I bet you a lot of you didn't even know that there was a memorare to Saint Joseph. Many of us know about the memorare to Our Lady, right? Which is a beautiful prayer. Love it. Always pray it, especially in, you know, emergency situations. It's a powerful prayer. But there's also one to Saint Joseph that's very similar. It just uses his name and some of his titles. So that's in the book, by the way. I prayed that on page 240 in the book. So before I begin today, day 2, and day 2 is a short day. It's probably the shortest day, because once we start tomorrow, we really start getting heavy. We go deep. We start diving deep into St. Joseph and really unpacking stuff, and it'll be pretty intense. Today is the easiest day. Yesterday, I did the preliminary stuff, and it took 45 minutes. Sorry about that. Usually, they're not going to go that long, but you guys didn't seem to mind, but I won't go that long every day. Now, many of you were asking about the book, because I guess a lot of you don't have it, which is fine, but please try and get it at some point, even if you can't get it during this 33-day series, get it later, and you were asking where to get it, and a lot of you are watching this from around the world. No kidding. You guys are amazing. I mean, you're watching from all over the globe. I'm so inspired by that. Man, it touches my heart so much. So if you want to get the book in the United States, the best website to get it is consecrationtosaintjoseph.org. Now, if you're in Canada or pretty much anywhere else around the world, you're probably going to have to get it through Amazon, because, you know, they carry stuff around the world. So if you're in Spain, you can get it in Spain on Amazon. If you're, anywhere else in Europe or Latin America, you know, they tend to have Amazon. You can get it from there. It might take longer to ship, of course, but you can get it from there. Now, there are places in like England and Ireland. There's a place called Veritas, and I believe that they are now printing it and selling it there in the UK. You can also go to Amazon UK and get it. Australia, there's a great organization called Perusia. I don't never know how to pronounce that word, where the accent is on that thing. But it's a great Catholic outfit, great people there with this guy named Charbel. They are now printing it and selling it for Australia and New Zealand. So please check that out. I'm super excited about this. It's now being printed and sold in the Philippines, right? Oh, Filipinos are so awesome. And they're going to eat this book up. Okay, day 2. So day 2, I talk about the litany of Saint Joseph because, you know, to put a book together like this, you need something like a template or a format, a method. Like, for example, Saint Louis de Montfort had his method for his total consecration to the Blessed Virgin, and it's brilliant. You know, you read from the Imitation of Christ, you do some readings, and then you do a lot of praying, and it's fantastic. It's really wonderful. So as I was coming up with this book, you know, I had a problem at first, because St. Louis de Montfort, he had the ability to rely upon the Marian doctrines and dogmas, at least the ones that were in existence at his time, right? There were several two that came after you know, his death, the Assumption, and the Immaculate Conception. But he still had, you know, certain doctrines to work with that he could make that a template for the book. I didn't have that with St. Joseph. You know, we don't have like dogmatic formulations about St. Joseph. So I couldn't structure the book in that similar way. We don't have a book that's comparable to The Imitation of Christ when it comes to St. Joseph. I mean, there's some great books on St. Joseph for sure. But I didn't know what to do. So I started putting the book together with all the research. Remember, I did a ton of research around the world. And I had people translate things for me from foreign languages that have never appeared in English before that talk about St. Joseph. Stuff from Poland, stuff from Spain, stuff even from Rome that popes have said that only was in Latin before, or like Italian, if it was an audience or something, and they gave it in Italian, but they never bothered to translate it into other languages. So or Malta as well, and some other countries. I had people translate these things for me. So I had all this material, and I set out to put it into the book. But after trying to come up with a program, I kind of freaked out because I was like, this isn't working. This isn't going to be smooth. This is just going to be like buckshot, man, just like throwing stuff on pages that's incoherent. There's not good transitions, and the material is good, the content, but man, this is not a good method. So I panicked, and that was about 4 months into it, putting the book together. And I basically, you know, if you could crumple up, you know, stuff in a computer, I crumpled up the papers and tossed it. And I realized that's not going to work. And I prayed to the Holy Spirit. I was like, Holy Spirit, you got to tell me how I'm going to put this book together. I have no idea. Well, you know what I was doing at the time, without even realizing it, I was praying the Litany of St. Joseph. And at one point, I think the Holy Spirit just opened my eyes because I was praying the Litany of St. Joseph. As I'm going through the litany, I start to count up the titles and even the beginning where you know you start a litany with God the Father of mercy, you know, God the Father of heaven, have mercy on us, God the Son, Redeemer of the world, all those kind of things. I counted it up and I was like, hold on a minute. There are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. There were 30 of them. And I was like, that is perfect. Because if there's 30, I can have an introduction that'll take a day or two. And then I can do a conclusion where we do the consecration. And all those in between, I can use as the head for every page for every day and just unpack that with St. Joseph's titles, privileges, and all of that kind of stuff. And that will make it in perfect accord with the church and what the church does in her public veneration of St. Joseph. And so then I knew the Litany of St. Joseph. That's the template for the book. And then it all came together and ran smooth as butter once I was able to get that down. So praise the Lord, praise the Holy Spirit for giving me that insight to be able to do it. So on day two, oh, and by the way, the litany that we are using here is the one that was codified, made official, only a little over 100 years ago in 1909 by Pope St. Pius X. There were litanies before that where you would get variations of different titles of St. Joseph, but this one now is pretty much the universal standard across the globe, and it's a powerful litany. And one of the things that I love about the Litany of St. Joseph is that it's unique. It's unique because there's a lot of other litanies out there, like, you know, you can have a litany to a certain saint, for example, and you call upon certain titles for them. And those are wonderful, but this one, along with the Litany of Loretto, the litany dedicated to Our Lady, there's something that you'll only find in these that you'll find in no others. For example, in the Litany of Loretto, we talk about Our Lady having the superlative of the virtues. So we call her the most chaste, right? The most of this, the most of that, the most of that, the most of this. Who do we do that with also? St. Francis of Assisi? No. The Little Flower? No. And they're awesome. I love those saints, by the way. They're awesome. Phenomenal. Right? But we never say the superlative for them. We don't have a litany to them that says, St. Francis, most loving. St. Francis, most, you know, this, that, and the other. We don't do that. We only do it with Mary and Joseph. Only Mary and Joseph do we do that with. That's extraordinary. So that's huge. Because as we get into the consecration of the days ahead, we'll see why that is. Because St. Joseph stands above all the other saints. He's just below Our Lady. That's extraordinary. So at the beginning, I have a quote from St. Teresa. Okay. She had an extraordinary devotion to St. Joseph. And again, we'll talk more about that later because I focus on her in a special way on another day. But she talks about how she has never known anyone to not make progress when they go to St. Joseph. And she knew this firsthand. And, you know, as Carmelites have kind of always had a particular special devotion to St. Joseph, and they carry that on to this day. It's a real blessing. You know, if there are any, you know, secular Carmelites watching this, you know this to be true. But the Carmelites and St. Joseph are really, really close. And she was a major player in that. Now, I go into this talking assuming that all of you know about St. Maximian Kolbe, the great St. Maximian Kolbe, right? One of my favorites, just a hero, a martyr of love, laying down his life, you know, for someone else. Just unbelievable. Many people have heard of him. I dare say most people have heard of St. Maximian Kolbe. But have you heard of Father Joseph Kempinek? Now, this guy is pretty much on the same level as Maximian Kolbe. It's just that not that many people know about him. He's a phenomenal man. He's actually on his way to sainthood. He's a servant of God right now. Which, you know, there's four stages to being canonized. You become a servant of God, which is the first step, then a venerable, then a blessed, then a saint. Well, he's at the first one, so they're studying his life and his writings, seeing if he was, you know, virtuous and all that stuff before he can be declared venerable. Well, this guy actually established a Marian organization of consecration, to spread consecration to the Blessed Virgin Mary, before St. Maximian Kolbe did. St. Maximian Kolbe founded his Militia Immaculata in 1917. Father Joseph Kempinek founded what is called the Schoenstatt movement in Germany in 1914, so 3 years prior to St. Maximian Kolbe's organization. And the similarities between St. Maximian Kolbe and Father Joseph Kempinek are uncanny. It's uncanny, really and truly. I'm going to show you a picture. I have it in one of my other books of Father Joseph Kempinek. You know, look at this. I mean, he's just got the holy look. Grow a beard like that, you know, and you're in. It's like, someday I'm going to, by the way. I can grow a beard like that. I did once years ago. Got it stuck in my zipper jacket one time, zipping up my jacket. I'll do it again someday. When I lose the hair on my head, I'll start growing it on my face. So, but that's him. I mean, just got the look of holiness. Holy, holy guy. And he went through some real trials. You know how St. Maximian Kolbe was caught, you know, by the Nazis and thrown into Auschwitz, where he gave his life. Well, Father Kempinek was caught by the Gestapo, and they said because of his health that he didn't have to go to a concentration camp. But you know what he did? He signed up for it. He volunteered, right, to go to Dachau. He signed up. He said, I'll go. Who does this? A saint. And why did he do it? Just randomly, I'll go. No, he wanted to suffer. He wanted to suffer for his Marian movement so that it would bear fruit. And he was in Dachau for 3 years. He was in Dachau concentration camp. Wow. And then, when he was released, he went through even more hardships. He was actually exiled from his own community that he started. And guess where he went? To Wisconsin. To around Milwaukee, Wisconsin area. So anybody watching here from that area, you know, you might have some familiarity with, you know, the servant of God, Joseph Kempinek, because he was there. There's a lot of Schoenstatt wayside shrines up in that area. Actually, every day on Facebook and on YouTube, there's these videos that I did, little one-minute videos for the consecration that we filmed at a Schoenstatt wayside shrine in Wisconsin. I don't remember the town. It's like out in the middle of a cornfield or something, but it's beautiful. A little quiet, little place to pray in front of the image of the Mother Thrice Admirable, the image associated with Schoenstatt. So he was a phenomenal man. And you know what he said in his form of Marian consecration? Because a lot of these saints, they got their different ways of talking about Marian consecration, right? You can be a slave of love. You can be the property of Mary. All these different ways. His way was called the covenant of love. And he talked about becoming an apparition of Mary when you're consecrated to her. Now that's odd. When you first hear that, it's like, wait, what? Well, not a literal apparition, but what he was getting at was that when you consecrate yourself to the Blessed Virgin Mary, people should see Mary in you, because you should become like her in her virtues, in her holiness. She's your spiritual mother. You should resemble her. I think that's brilliant, to be an apparition of Mary in the world. Boy, do we need such apparitions. But what about Joseph? See, this is what I get into on the second day. As we're going to unpack the litany of St. Joseph, I said to myself, that was brilliant what Father Kentenich did. Why don't we do this with St. Joseph? So if we consecrate ourselves to St. Joseph, we can become apparitions of Joseph in the world today. And boy, do we need such apparitions. And this applies to everyone, by the way, because we're talking about virtues. But in a special way, we need a lot of men who are like St. Joseph, who are servant leaders, who are stepping up, who are providing, who are so loving, so caring, so compassionate, and so dedicated to the end, to be willing to die for those who are entrusted to your care. We need apparitions of Joseph in the world today. So I thought that was brilliant. So I ended up putting it in the book. I just thought that was such a unique thing. Now, as I said, today is a light day, the lightest day that we have. And it's just showing that we're going to unpack the Litany of St. Joseph for the remaining days, going title by title through it. And it's really amazing what you're going to discover and what you're going to learn. I learned so many things doing this. I really did. And one thing that I learned is that in the Latin Litany of St. Joseph, some of the titles come across even stronger. The translations in the English sometimes are kind of weak. But I also included in the back of the book, the Litany of St. Joseph in Latin. Now, you might not know how to pronounce some of these things. It can be a little tricky if you're not familiar, with it. But you can still give it a go. And it's powerful sometimes when you pray that in Latin. It has a certain punch to it, because you can pick up on what it's saying, and it just has a certain cadence and a certain punch to it. So I put that in here as well. So we're going to use the litany, and we're going to look to St. Joseph as our model. Models are meant to be replicated. So when we look to St. Joseph, we want to keep an eye on the days ahead on these particular virtues and try and apply them in our own life. Because this is what it means to be consecrated to Our Lady or to St. Joseph, is to become like them, is to become an apparition of Mary, is to become an apparition of Joseph in the world. So my friends, I'm going to be praying for you as we go through this, that you would see this change in yourself. So far, the people that have done the book have told me incredible things. They really have. I've had some conversations with men who have said that, Father, I have struggled with the sin of lust for so many years, falling into the same habitual sins, but something has changed in me with this consecration. Because I now see that I can be like St. Joseph. And even though I've messed it up in the past, I've still got a pulse. I've still got hope, which means that I can change for the better. And Father, something has happened. I'm finding myself not going back to that same filth that I used to go to, and something's different. There was actually two women that told me that they suffered from insomnia, right? Just could not sleep, never got a good night's sleep. And this went on for decades, long times. And they told me that they, after doing the consecration, they just felt that they could rest, that they could totally surrender, let go of all those anxieties, because they knew that St. Joseph was watching over them, and they had that peace of heart. And they found themselves throughout the day doing little acts, little things, to imitate St. Joseph and his virtues, because he's our model. He's our model for how to be a more faithful Christian, to be more dedicated to Jesus Christ, more zealous in that. And remember, his name means increase. He's going to increase our virtue. He's going to increase our closeness to Jesus Christ. And he's going to decrease our vices and all the things in our life that are taking us away from Jesus Christ. That's what this is all about. Blessed William Joseph Chaminade, he said this: St. Joseph's eminent virtues constitute his merit, and he becomes our model. St. Peter Julian Imard said this: St. Joseph is our guide and our model. Because our vocation is like his, we must live his life, practice his virtues, and assimilate his spirit. Wow, how awesome is that? To think that we're able to do this, that the Holy Spirit is wanting us to do this. Do you know how privileged that we are? I mean, I feel spoiled from heaven. I really do. I think to myself sometimes, why is all of this being shown to me? I'm nobody. I'm no better than anybody else. Why is my mind able to grasp this and my heart able to delight in these things when the world seems to be going by? And I just want to go sometimes out on the street and say, everybody, are you aware of what we have, of what the Catholic Church has? As I see so many people running off to New Age movements and trying to do self-help remedies of trying to better themselves and do it yourself this and do it yourself that. And it ends up disappointed, losing your money, and usually with a lot of drama and heartache. We've got such models in the Catholic Church. We've got treasures. We have got a treasure trove of so many blessings. And St. Joseph is right there at the top. And so many people, they haven't known this, you know, for a long time, because as I said, there hasn't been really any dogmatic or even doctrinal formulations with St. Joseph. I pray that happens one day. You know, I really do. I don't know if we're ever going to get anything like a dogma of St. Joseph's, you know, eminent sanctity, or that he was sanctified in the womb or something like that, but I think it would be wonderful. Maybe someday we'll get more liturgical feasts in honor of St. Joseph. You know, I've often thought about that. When I was putting this book together, it dawned upon me, these titles in the litany are so amazing. Do you know what the church needs, in my opinion, right? We have a mass book. Us priests, we're familiar with it. Maybe some of you are as well, if you're, you know, hanging out in the sacristy. We have a mass book of votive masses to the Blessed Virgin Mary, and they're beautiful. Oh, man, if you look at the titles of some of them and the prayers, it is phenomenal. As a matter of fact, when I was first ordained a priest, you know what I did? I made it a point, whenever I was not liturgically impeded, to celebrate every one of those votive masses of the Blessed Virgin Mary as soon as I could. And I was able to do it within, like, you know, 3 months or something. You know, it wasn't that hard to do. It was lovely. You know, I wanted to have all of those, you know, Mother of Mercy, Fountain of Life, beautiful titles for Our Lady. What if the church had a book of votive masses to St. Joseph? Can you imagine how awesome that would be? If there's any bishop who's watching this, if Cardinal Sarah is watching this video right now, brother, do it. We need something like this right now. The church, this would flourish. We would have an unbelievable, you know, just growth, like overnight, if priests had this ability to do this. Right now we have like, you know, a couple masses for St. Joseph. The Solemnity on March 19th, you know, May 1st, St. Joseph the Worker. And then there's a few others where maybe he's mentioned in brief, like the Holy Family, you know, in December. But can you imagine if we had like 20 masses, I don't know, to St. Joseph that came from the titles from the Litany of St. Joseph? Can you imagine? We're going to unpack these, but let's just take a look at some of these to see what we would be dealing with. A votive mass to St. Joseph Most Chaste. I think that would greatly help with purity. And do we not need purity today? You betcha we do. St. Joseph Most Courageous. Oh, we need some courageous Christians today, for sure. Most Obedient, Most Faithful, Patient. Oh, Pillar of Families. St. Joseph, Pillar of Families. Today's Mass is for St. Joseph, Pillar of Families. Wow. Kidding me? Comforter of the Afflicted, Patron of the Dying, Terror of Demons, baby. Can you imagine if we had a votive mass to St. Joseph, Terror of Demons? Please, Cardinal Sarah, if you're watching this, somebody send this puppy to Cardinal Sarah so we can get this thing going. We need stuff like this today. We can turn things around. We got to look to these prayers approved by the church, and that's what we're going to do. We're going to unpack it, my friends. We're going to unpack it. As a matter of fact, right now, what we're going to do, we're going to pray the Litany of St. Joseph, and that'll close today. As I said, today's a short day. All right, so if you have the book, the Litany of St. Joseph is on page 233, and I'll do the whole thing, and wherever you are, you just respond according to where you're at. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Christ, hear us. Christ, graciously hear us. God, the Father of heaven, have mercy on us. God, the Son, Redeemer of the world, have mercy on us. God, the Holy Spirit, have mercy on us. Holy Trinity, one God, have mercy on us. Holy Mary, pray for us. Saint Joseph, pray for us. Noble offspring of David, pray for us. Light of patriarchs, pray for us. Spouse of the Mother of God, pray for us. Chaste guardian of the Virgin, pray for us. Foster father of the Son of God, pray for us. Zealous defender of Christ, pray for us. Head of the Holy Family, pray for us. Joseph most just, pray for us. Joseph most chaste, pray for us. Joseph most prudent, pray for us. Joseph most courageous, pray for us. Joseph most obedient, pray for us. Joseph most faithful, pray for us. Mirror of patience, pray for us. Lover of poverty, pray for us. Model of workmen, pray for us. Glory of domestic life, pray for us. Guardian of virgins, pray for us. Pillar of families, pray for us. Comfort of the afflicted, pray for us. Hope of the sick, pray for us. Patron of the dying, pray for us. Terror of demons, pray for us. Protector of the Holy Church, pray for us. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, spare us, O Lord. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, graciously hear us, O Lord. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. He has made him Lord of his household and prince over all his possessions. Let us pray. O God, who in your loving providence chose blessed Joseph to be the spouse of your most holy mother, grant us the favor of having him for our intercessor in heaven, whom on earth we venerate as our protector. You who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. And Heavenly Father, we thank you for this second day of consecration to Saint Joseph. Help us to become apparitions of Saint Joseph in the world. Help us to have him as our model, to assimilate his spirit, and to acquire his virtues, because they are desperately needed in the world today. Saint Joseph, we run to you. As we prayed in the Memorare, we fly to you. Help us with your mighty, powerful protection, because you are our spiritual father. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, Amen.